Welcome back to Crystal Clear. I'm Ulrich Vox, and we're back with our second half of the Steve Universe movie breakdown. No time to waste. Let's just pick up where we left off. And if you missed the first part, you can go check that out. Oh, and spoiler warning, because you haven't watched the movie. Embarking on a search party to find Amethyst, Steven and Spinel search throughout Beach City, which paves the way for little details and continuity. We can see Petey no longer has Hot to Tot, his tater tot food truck he repurposed out of Mayor Dewey's van. Now back to working at Beach City Walk Fries. But notice he looks older, with a slightly longer neck.
Like Steven.
And he just appears to be, I guess the right word would be longer. Like, yeah, he looks a bit taller, but his arms also look longer. In general, he looks like he's maturing. He also has a new blazer with a white button-up. Meanwhile, Onion hasn't aged at all. Why is that? Probably because he's secretly half alien as well. Or it's just a gag, but you know, a theorist can dream. Speaking of gags, in each shot during the sequence, Onion somehow manages to beat Steven, Spinel, and Lion to the punch, standing next to an uncorrupted court soldier at Funland and eating a donut in the Big Donut as Lars prepares to serve another customer. Quirky or alien? Steven tracks down Amethyst at Vidalia's art studio, with various paintings of Amethyst that call back to the episode Onion Friend. Steven attempts to jog Amethyst's memory with a song, no matter what, with tap dancing provided by Shelby Ribara. Now, I find this song very clever in the context of the movie, as it utilizes Amethyst's habit of repeating whatever Steven says and does to blend into a rhythm. As Steven buys fries for him and Amethyst to indulge in, we can spot a Bordy conversing with two uncrypted gems. Nice to see more integration, even if it's just casual. Steven and Amethyst cheating at Skee Ball is a callback to Arcade Mania, where Amethyst did the exact same thing. That's also an episode that has Steven wear an extra layer of pink clothing with his old coat. Just saying. I really just want to shout out that quick joke of Ronaldo trying to take a picture of Amethyst Ronaldo, only for his passcode to be way too long and Amethyst losing interest, running away before Ronaldo looks up. Amethyst entering the hole she emerged out of, with Steven extending his hand to pull her out, parallels On the Run, where Pearl was the one to pull a sobbing Amethyst out of her hole. A day of repetition and rejogging causes Amethyst to regain her memory, cycling through her various forms from throughout the series, including the many she forced in the episode Reformed, until she hits her current reformation. Yeah, no new forms this time, folks. This is also a good time to address that Spinel throughout the second act is never really included in the festivities, but rather she just follows and observes, much like her relationship with Pink Diamond before her abandonment. This includes her and the hug between Steven and Amethyst, forcing her way in. Noticing the state of Beach City is getting worse due to the injector, Steven informs Nanofoil that they need to open up the shelters in case of evacuation, a procedure Nanofoil and the Crystal Gems developed in Letters to Lars, coming into play in Reunited. Now, we already broke down Peridot's screen in our Toonami trailer breakdown, but yes, she's rewatching Camp Hiding Hearts, having it paused while trying to seize the end of the world. And one of the greatest details in this movie, Peridot's new Robonoids now wear visors similar to hers. Peridot has also utilized more of Earth's technology, adapting a microwave and her tablet to her scientific endeavors. The TV PGV rating begins to flex as some of the biopoison burns to Steven's jacket, damaging his arm. Realizing they can't shut down Spinel's injector without learning more about her, Steven decides it's time to get Pearl back. But her and Garnet are still tangled up with Greg. And I just gotta say, Garnet's fascination with the red and blue wires is a cute joke with Ruby and Sapphire. Ruby's half drawn to the red wire, while Sapphire's half is drawn to the blue. Trying to figure out which one Greg needs, which is the most important, but Greg is just telling them it doesn't matter. Can't get enough of it. Now, in order to jog Pearl's memory, Steven and Amethyst bring her to a rock show, performance by none other than Sadie Killer and the Suspects. Though the concept of a rock show restoring Pearl's memory is a callback to Last One Out of Beach City, a defining episode for Pearl's character arc. Sadie's hair is now blonde with green tips. Remember, she dyed her hair completely green right before the time skip, as shown through the end of Change Your Mind. So either she's just let it grow out without re-dyeing it, or she dyed it back to her natural color, with green at the very end. Sadie Killer and the Suspects, alongside Amethyst on drums, an instrument she's shown to be proficient with since Steven and the Stevens, perform the song Disobedient. This musical number's creation was provided with the help of Mike Kroll, whose songs popped up along with himself in Last One Out of Beach City. Of course, this song is meant to bring back Pearl's memory, as being disobedient is key to her development and history, rebelling against homeworld with Rose Quartz. On that note, Amethyst tries to pull out the Rose Quartz card after Greg consents. Remember, last time Amethyst shapeshifted into Rose was to spite and hurt Greg in the episode Maximum Capacity. Yet here, it has no effect on Pearl. The only thing that could get her attention off of Greg is if Greg ceased to exist, which Steven realizes they can pull off with fusion, bringing Steg into the world. Now, I already did an entire breakdown of Steg in a separate video, and with both parts, this breakdown is already tremendously long, so please, I encourage you to go check that out if you haven't. As Pearl regains a recollection of her memories, cycling through her forms, her pilot design briefly cameos as a silhouette, dancing in front of Rose Quartz. After regaining her memories, Pearl fuses with Amethyst into Opal, which brings her second speaking appearance, her first of course being Giant Woman, and her first full-blown musical number, bringing her back in style. Also notice, because of Amethyst and Pearl's reformations, Opal appears with her own brand new look, although I was hoping she would carry Pearl's jacket. Exhausted from fusion and his power still repressed, Steven's drained of energy and reduced to a state similar to the climax of Change Your Mind when his gemstone was removed, with noticeable dark circles under his eyes and a severe lack of energy, although Steven here isn't even close to that level. Remembering the sensation of being left behind and abandoned, Spinel flees to Steven's diamond base, taking our hero to Pink Diamond's garden, the place where Spinel never left. Spinel's memories of her and Pink Diamond playing include Spinel juggling, which was once an activity Pink Diamond would do for her original Pearl, as seen in Together Alone. We also get a glimpse of the moment Pink Diamond was granted her own colony, and through the body language of Blue and Yellow Diamond, it seems Blue Diamond was stressing the importance of this colony and to not screw anything up, likely to avoid disappointing White Diamond, and whatever punishment would follow. However, Yellow Diamond seems optimistic and, well, happy for Pink, putting on a reassuring face. This checks out with Yellow's line of dialogue in Reunited, on how she knew Pink Diamond wasn't ready for a colony, but gave in anyways. However, it appears even Yellow Diamond was annoyed by Spinel, which makes her reaction towards reuniting with Spinel even sweeter. Spinel explains her abandonment through the song Drift Away, which you guys may recognize Spinel's motif within the song, going at the same pace of the San Diego Comic-Con 2018 teaser trailer for the film. Going back to the opening of the film with the brief glimpse of Spinel standing in place, her feet wrapped in the overgrowth of the garden, we now see her for the first time in 6,000 years, heartbroken over the realization that Pink Diamond never intended to come back for her. Spinel regains her memory and her form and is comforted by Steven, leading into the song Found. But notice how, although Steven invites Spinel back to Earth to make new friends, harmonizing with her on the prospect moving on from Pink Diamond, he never once actually states, he'll be her friend. He never says, you can make new friends with me. You can be happy with me. It sets up Spinel's relapse and paranoia of Steven using her, and how Steven's image of happily ever after may be doing more harm than good, depending on the angle you look at everything. This can even be read through the facial expression Steven shoots at Spinel once they get back to Earth, eager and anxious to get everything over with. As Amethyst, Pearl, and Garnet await Steven's return, we see Garnet's captivated by a spork, a fusion of a fork and a spoon. Connie arrives in a NASA astronaut trainee uniform, sword in hand, landing with Lion in an Akira-style shot. We covered this in our Toonami trailer breakdown, but the anime film Akira features a shot of protagonist Kaneda putting the brakes on his bike that's been parodied and paid tribute to in multiple animated projects over the years. Spinel removes her injector and saves the day, but no, Spinel says, what are friends for, after Steven thanks her, only for Steven to not say anything back. It again sets up what's to follow seconds after, with Spinel realizing Steven only wanted her to stop the injector, immediately disregarding her as soon as it's removed, pushing Spinel on a downward spiral, amped up by the rejuvenator falling out of Steven's pocket. Remember, he couldn't put it into Lion's mane earlier in the film, and Spinel assumes Steven was plotting to use it on her. Spinel reinserts the injector, creating a battlefield within a newly formed crater. But notice what she says to Steven. You expect me to believe you like me like this? Spinel's anger is being directed at herself. Her doubt and insecurity comes across as if she's lashing out and pushing others away, making herself out to be the supervillain she thinks she is in order to avoid being hurt again. This is also reflected once more through her eyes, adding another layer to her irises each time she feels pushed to the breaking point. Attempting to explain the truth to Spinel causes Garnet's memory to be restored, as she remembers that facing the truth with the people you love can get you through any hardship in life. This bridges into True Kind of Love, a song that was a collaborative effort with Chance the Rapper, Macy Stewart, James Fauntleroy, and Julian Zorzi Sanchez. And you guys may recognize this as the big theme used to advertise the film. During the battle that commences during the song, notice that Spinel already begins to hesitate and reflect in her actions, notably each time she appears in Garnet's visor, Garnet's lyrics reflecting how Spinel truly feels. Now, this rematch with Spinel Pearl serves as a parallel to how Spinel poofed the gems earlier in the film. Garnet holds onto Pearl, who anchors Amethyst's whip, so Amethyst can kick Spinel right in the center of her chest, sending Spinel flying, but she recovers on a leg of her injector, launching at Steven, but being intercepted by Garnet, who takes advantage of Spinel's elastic properties alongside Amethyst and Pearl to catapult her into the injector, similar to how Spinel catapulted herself into poofing Garnet, Amethyst, and Pearl in the first act of the film. Spinel forces out the rest of the injector's poison onto Beach City, causing it to rip through the landscape. A lot of people are wondering why didn't the planet just crumble right then and there, but it's because Spinel rushed the process despite the gems that prevented the poison from properly incubating and destroying the planet. Her plan went out the window then and there, as her target for revenge shifted from Pink Diamond to Steven. The idea was no longer to destroy the Earth, just to make Steven suffer as quickly and effective as possible. The gems, Connie, and Lion scatter to evacuate the town and move everyone to safety as Steven scales up the injector. Garnet, Amethyst, and Pearl form Alexandrite, who has a new look due to the new reformations. Most notably, her visor is now tri-ponged, with the three lenses around Pearl's gem now golden. During this evacuation, Greg gets hit by the poison, which is really just a setup of the kissing joke later in the resolution. Yeah, for a second I thought something crazy was going to happen, like Greg would get a robot arm, but no, just setting up a gag is fine too, I guess. Steven faces Spinel, attempting to reason with her, but instead yells in frustration, getting decked in the face twice in a row as a result. Steven's nose beginning to bleed. Hell yeah, TV PGV! Steven calls out the story of his life, finding himself back at square one with the trials and tribulations he endured throughout the series, only to realize the missing piece is change. Steven's been too caught up in happily ever after, and not wanting a single thing to change, that he's forgotten a fundamental part of his life. With this emotional breakthrough, he's able to restore his powers stronger than ever. Steven summons two shields, then his bubble, powering it up into their spike state, before toggling into shields that resemble acids and crystals, hinting that Steven is able to tap into the power of Pink Steven. His gemstone's physical form devoid of all personality and restraint, only leaving raw power in its place. You guys may be aware that I really want Steven to have some kind of diamond transformation that allows him to tap into Pink Steven's powers, what Pink Steven's shield looks like, so this was incredible to see, and I hope they expand upon it. Steven's final battle with Spinel is set to the song Change, another sequence animated by Takafumi Hori. According to his own tweet, I was in charge of the first few scenes and the animation of The Other Friends, but I was not able to do it alone because I finished it while taking the advice of the crew. The song part depends on Mickey Brewster and Jeff Liu, who are in charge of the storyboard. In an interview with Comic Book, Sugar also elaborated a bit more. The Other Friends and Chain sequences are incredible because we got to collaborate with Takafumi Hori. He did the animation for those sequences, it's just phenomenal. Mickey Brewster boarded Other Friends, and Change was the last song we wrote for the film at the very, very end. And so I worked on that with Jeff Liu as he was storyboarding that sequence. Jeff Liu invented this idea of Spinel just launching Steven to the sky and then jumping after him, and they're just flying through the air. That whole sequence is just so amazing. Brilliant concept from Jeff, and then beautifully animated by Takafumi Hori. It just feels so intensely Steven Universe. Key details that I appreciate during this fight is Spinel punching herself right upside the head as Steven tries to appease to her, trying to stay in her current toxic mindset as a way to avoid getting hurt again. And we see a new subsection of Steven's powers, using his bubble abilities to create boxing gloves. But we'll break down Steven's new powers entirely in a separate video. Spinel's final attack on Steven is very similar to Monkey D. Luffy's Gear 3rd ability in One Piece. Like, come on guys, this is the exact same ability.
Rebecca Sugar ain't slick!
Now, what I really enjoy about Spinel's redemption isn't that they just talk things out, but rather they fight with Steven trying to talk her down from her position. Spinel only breaks down in caves, seizing the fight once she runs out of steam. It embraces an aspect of Steven Universe I love that we don't really get to see. The action! After an explosion in which both Steven and Spinel survive, Connie and Lion come to Steven's aid, and you'd think Connie and Steven would kiss, yet they don't. Rebecca Sugar has commented on this, and Connie's kiss on Steven's cheek earlier in the film, in an interview with TV Line, stating, "Well, they love each other. It's not a question to me. It felt intuitive, and he's finally in peacetime, so the hope is that he's going to have some great teenage experiences like a normal human being." Before that gets ripped away from him. Internally, it was a bit of a no-brainer. We just knew that was where they were at, and Connie was bound to be a little more forward than Steven. Steven begins kissing the Earth to heal it, which I suppose our theory on Steven healing the Earth was right, just played a bit more comedically. And the diamonds arrive, their music cue being lifted from Pink Diamond's ship emerging and legs from it to Homeworld. White Diamond judging Beach City's destroyed state is ironic, considering Homeworld is in ruin. And the diamonds reunite with Spinel, taking her in, easily warming up to her. Emperor, serving one of this movie's purposes and being an epilogue to the Diamond Days arc. Whereas Pink was the heart of the Diamond's family dynamic before, Spinel will now fill that new place. Although I believe Steven will still have the title of Pink Diamond, but again, future videos for that. As the film wraps up with the musical number finale, taking on inspiration from Broadway right down to the characters on stage, their outfits may seem familiar to you, as their designs built upon from this 2016 San Diego Comic-Con poster, with some colors and details altered here and there. But beyond that, they're identical. It's amazing to see art like this make its way into the series itself. Greg hands Steven a bouquet of roses and hibiscus flowers, once again representing both sides to Rose Quartz and Pink Diamond. And with that, Steven vs. the Movie comes to a close. Woo! That was a lot to break down, and it took two videos, but I think we did it. That being said, there still could have been things we missed, so if we did, let us know in the comments below, or tweet them at RoundTableVids. And for my own thoughts, you can find me at Osric Vox. We're also on Instagram. Help the Roundtable grow by either becoming a member of this channel, or supporting us over at Patreon. Link in the description. If you enjoyed the video, please throw it a like, and subscribe to the Roundtable for more great cartoon content. Thank you for watching, and I hope you have an awesome day. Osric Vox, signing out.